Good evening, welcome to this retrofitting updated meeting brought to you by Edinburgh Trades Union Council. For the recording, it's Tuesday the 7th of December 2021 and it's been 5 months since our first meeting on retrofitting. On a cold and blustery night where we've seen snow in the city and with the prospects of further price hikes for fueling our own homes, tonight our aim is to provide updates for our Edinburgh retrofitting campaign. We wish to prepare for the local authority election campaign in May, and off the back of a staggering response and the unsurprising failings of COP26, continue the local campaign regarding climate change. Since our last meeting, our Secretary Des has met with council officials and will speak to a report that he's since drafted. And we are delighted to welcome back our original meeting speakers. They are Unite member and author Ellen Robottom from Leeds Trade Union Council, Professor Linda Clarke from the University of Westminster, Stuart Graham from Glasgow Trade Union Council, and Des Loughney for Edinburgh Trade Union Council. Before I welcome the first speaker, may I remind you to remain muted when we're listening to speakers, but to feel free to use the closed captions that are available if they're required, and to use the chat function to share notes, links to websites or documents. Thank you. So the format of the meeting will be to hear from Ellen, Linda, Stuart, then Des, have an opportunity to ask any questions or make any comment between speakers. And then after all the speakers have updated us, can throw the meeting open to have questions or to share ideas of how to move our campaigns forward, if that's okay. We're aiming to finish at 8 o'clock. So if that's all fine with you, I'd like to welcome our first speaker this evening. Thank you very much for sharing your time again with us, Ellen. I welcome you to our meeting.
Thanks, Claire. And I think most of the people on the call tonight have were probably. Oh, sorry, my phone. Most people on the call were here at the previous meeting. So, but I'm just going to just very briefly set the scene to how we began with this work in Leeds and specifically in Leeds Trades Council. So back in the summer of 2020, we produced our document called Decarbonising Leeds Homes with a huge programme of deep retrofitting and installation of heat pumps. I've just been reading back on it today, and it's I'm quite impressed with it with it as a document. But also, there are some areas where I now feel, with the benefit of further experience and discussions, that perhaps it's a bit naive in places as well. But yeah, we can go on to that. But the important thing is just picking out a number of the points that we made. That obviously a retrofit programme has extremely high potential for job creation, although big implications for training requirements, which I think Linda's going to say more about. Very important co-benefits. Obviously, it fits well into the framework of a just transition in the sense that it's the biggest benefits go to the people on the lowest incomes. It has the potential to eliminate the problem of fuel poverty, which is certainly rampant in Leeds and through most of the UK, I think. The other important point that we wanted to make is the private sector construction industry is chaotic, you know, precarious working conditions, lack of accountability, huge problems with a lot of the projects that have in Leeds, certainly, that have been privately financed. And we want to move away from that. As far as possible, we want to move towards a retrofitting programme which uses in-house labour where people are directly employed by the local authority, which is suitably funded to be able to carry out that work. And all those points are very consistent with the current policy of the TUC. I don't know, I've not read up on the Scottish TUC policy on this, but People can perhaps fill in on that later. And I've just laid that out as an introduction because in terms of an update, the document that I'm talking about did have attached to it a motion, which was subsequently taken by one of our Trades Council delegates to their Unite branch. And bearing in mind that this happened towards the end of last summer, summer of 2020, that motion has now finally made its way to the Unite National Executive, where it's been the subject of a meeting with some of the national officers. And they are seriously looking at it. What's happened from that meeting is that it's been sent to some of their sort of professional research people to research the implications of a mass retrofit policy, what the financial implications are, what the funding possibilities are, what the training requirements might be, and essentially to work it up into something that stands, that can stand as a national policy. And we've been comrade who attended that meeting went to a follow-up meeting yesterday. I think he was a little bit disappointed by the sort of lack of progress in the few weeks in between. But essentially, the idea is that motion, once it's been knocked into shape, will go to the General Secretary for endorsement and will become essentially union policy. From our point of view in Leeds, one of the interesting things about that discussion has been that they were looking into the possibility of pursuing a strategy that's about using Leeds as a kind of pilot, as a kind of way of trialing an approach which potentially could see a sort of a street by street mixed tenure kind of approach to getting this work done, using insourced labour and using various sources of funding which they would kind of support us to research and to have talks with the council. And there is going to be where we've got to that at the moment is that there's a meeting planned between the council leader and the Unite convener for council employees in Leeds, and also the Unite regional officer who was instrumental in getting that motion through to national exec level. So things, after all this time of really nothing very much happening, things do seem to be moving. But I think what we're still lacking on the ground is what our original ambition was, which was to really pull together a very active coalition of grassroots groups, including union branches and including the various community organisations and campaign groups that we've got. However, again, really only in the last two, three months, I would say, work has started to be done with a community organisation called Our Future Leeds. And I believe there's now an Our Future Edinburgh, am I right in that, that is just starting to get off the ground? And it's, I don't know how that will look in other cities, but it looks as though people are looking to Leeds as a kind of a model for what could be possible. I see that somebody's, yes, I am actually now technically a published author now that the new climate jobs booklet has come out, and I'll put the links in the chat later on to that. So our Future Leeds, grassroots community organisation that tries to look into various aspects of where we want Leeds to be by 2030, for example, in terms of both sustainability and also in terms of social justice outcomes, so which are obviously very, very closely linked anyway. So just transition stuff, but on the ground at a local level, and very much kind of acting as a, you might say, a critical friend to the council, pushing them in areas where they're not doing good enough in terms of meeting their own targets for decarbonisation. And Our Future Leeds now has a working group on housing and home energy, which has had a couple of very productive meetings in the last few weeks, where that have brought together an interesting combination of people, campaigners, retrofit practitioners, architects, and finally the principal of Leeds College of Building, who really does need to be on board. Up to now, really, there's been some kind of quite detailed work on exploring the options for technologies that have been done by people who understand these things, who do it as part of their work, and also quite a lot of brainstorming from people in the meetings about what the sort of barriers might be in terms of, obstacles to take up, I think an interesting one is people mistrusting the technologies, because basically the right-wing tabloids have been running a big scare campaign about, oh, you're all going to be forced to have heat pumps and it's going to be so expensive. And I think that that's, I don't believe that heat pumps are a panacea, and nobody does. But that kind of negative publicity is a barrier. Obviously, finance is a barrier. The very low level of trained of well-trained workers in the field is a barrier. So really, we're kind of at the stage of looking at what all these barriers are and how we can approach them. In the meantime, just quickly, we now have a West Yorkshire mayor. So the West Yorkshire Combined Authority is another level at which to work, because it's very much going to be the case that Leeds, Bradford, Wakefield, that group of towns and cities will be having to collaborate over this stuff, both in terms of planning, of seeking funding, and they've quite recently published a roadmap on every aspect, really, of decarbonisation in the county. But I've just been looking at the one on housing and home energy. It's a bit weak, to be honest. It talks about bringing the almost all homes and businesses to a level of an energy efficiency level of EPC C rating, which is kind of adequate but not great, but it doesn't talk about training for insulating. It doesn't talk about the need to train insulators, and of course it's a very specific skill set. It requires understanding of the thermal dynamics of the whole house and what's implied by that, and it also seems to assume that in the 2030s, we're all going to have either we're going to all have heat pumps, or we're all going to be connected up to hydrogen in place of methane in our gas boilers. And it talks about training for installing those technologies, but it doesn't talk about the training for insulating. So there's quite a lot of holes and gaps and perhaps you might say lack of ambition as well within that. I'm conscious that I'm running out of time, but I think one of the points that I really want to make that might be helpful to think about is just that there are now loads and loads of groups working on this in different ways. There are groups of people who actually do this stuff, but want to find ways of scaling it up. There are campaign groups at local level, there are campaign groups at county and regional level and at national level. And there are so many different people all working in the same space that it's getting really confusing and quite overwhelming. So one of the things that, and clearly alliances and coordinated action on this is absolutely essential. And of course, making sure that trade unions and workers and also residents have a voice and a place at the centre of it. And one of the things that I think, now I've mentioned this at other meetings, most of us did a huge amount of work in building coalitions around the mobilisations for COP26. And it's only a beginning. To my mind, it's only a beginning, but we have formed alliances, we've made relationships, we've made connections between groupings that have never worked together before. So people in Extinction Rebellion, for example, who were barely aware of what trade unions do, and vice versa. And then, you know, other groups that are working on specific campaigns at different levels have all really started getting to know each other, understand each other's ways of working, started to, you know, define and identify shared objectives. And I think that this is something we need to really carry on building, because we need that campaign infrastructure. Because at the end of the day, none of this can happen unless we can get movement from our national governments, both at, you know, both at UK level and also at English and Scottish levels. And in order to do that, we need a powerful campaign that's where people are linked up at every level. So, yeah, I guess my final sort of plea would be, let's not lose the work that we've done around the COP26. Let's move it forward and build it bigger. That's me for now.
Thanks very much, Ellen, for updating us on where you are in Leeds. I love your idea of being the council's critical friend. I think that's terrific. Okay, thank you. Can I ask if there's anybody that wanted to ask Ellen more specifically about something that she has mentioned, or make a comment about anything that you've just heard? Just have a little look. I don't see anybody at the moment. Ellen, you're off the hook. Oh, I beg your pardon. There's Graham. He's put his hand up. Graham, since you have got your hand up first, may I welcome you, and then Cathy next. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Ellen. I was just wondering, I've been speaking to some EPC assessors on sort of the easiest way in order to improve EPC scores, and sort of raise sort of solar panels are quite an easy way to do it. Has there been any work around this? Obviously, in sort of full council tenure blocks, you'd have full access to the roof. Is there anything that this been to sort of explored down in Leeds at all?
So, yeah, there's very little. I think solar panels are mentioned in the West Yorkshire roadmap, but very much something that comes later. And to an extent, that's correct, because it's important to have a fabric first approach, and the insulating comes first, regardless of what energy technologies you want to use. But the people that are discussing in the Our Future Leeds group are very much also looking at thinking about what are the better heat and energy technologies for different types of buildings. And of course there are other ones that are less well known, like solar collectors and thermal stores for thermal batteries for buildings as well. So I think that we're at a relatively low level of awareness about the different types of, you know, there's a bit of an idea that everybody's supposed to be having heat pumps, and then that creates controversy because people have had heat pumps that didn't work very well or were very expensive. But obviously, I'd just like to say I did, having worked on the buildings chapter for the climate jobs booklet, I then went on to work on the energy chapter, and energy technologies was something I knew very little about until I started looking into it. But it became extremely clear to me through doing that there's no way we can decarbonize the energy system unless we get rid of these enormous peaks in demand that come from the domestic sector in terms of heating. So, it just made it all the more clear that how much that has to be a priority, but also that we very much are going to need dispersed sources of energy generation and storage as well, because otherwise the transmission system won't cope with it, or it'll just require such massive amounts of additional resources that it won't be anything you could call climate friendly. Sorry to go on a bit there.
Thanks very much for that, Ellen.
Okay, thanks for that, Ellen. Cathy, would you like to come in now?
Yeah, I just excuse my ignorance, but I'm asking a question about hydrogen. Because, you know, various people are now starting to say, oh, I'll be fine. I have a gas boiler. It'll just become hydrogen. you know, blah, blah, blah. And I, my perception from the little bit of reading I've done, which isn't very much, is that that technology is a long way from actually being possible, particularly in a domestic setting. So I just thought I would ask Ellen, you know, to update me a bit on that.
No, I'm glad you've mentioned that, because I can sometimes not make assumptions about where people are at with that. Actually, no, we're very clear that that's not what we're supporting. That is one of the options that's put forward in the West Yorkshire roadmap. But if you read the original Leeds document, we actually talk about the sort of pitfalls with that. The fact that the plan is that it will initially, the hydrogen will be what's colloquially called blue hydrogen, which is hydrogen that's produced from methane, i.e. from natural gas, and that the emissions are supposed to be mitigated by the use of carbon capture and storage. So there are all kinds of problems with that. I mean, firstly, you know, extracting methane generates greenhouse gas emissions, regardless of what you then do with the methane. You know, there's always fugitive emissions, and they're very powerful greenhouse gases, especially in the short term. But there is no demonstration of carbon capture and storage at the scale and efficiency that we would need it to achieve the emissions cuts that we're really looking for. And also, as you say, that people who are kind of looking into the finance and the sort of the way that it's being planned, it wouldn't be on stream at any scale until the mid-30s anyway, and we're looking for the cuts much sooner than that. The plan is then to sort of transition it over to green hydrogen, which is produced by electrolysis of water. And that's quite energy intensive in itself. So it implies a much bigger burden on the on renewable energy, renewable electricity generation. It is not dismissing green hydrogen, because I think it will be needed to some scale as a storage, an energy storage technology, at least in the shorter term, because there are other ones that will come on stream that might be better. But the idea of pumping hydrogen into people's domestic boilers as a substitute for methane is not popular amongst environmental campaigners.
Thank you. That's really helpful.
Thank you. Sophia, I see your hand up. What would you like to ask?
Ellen, all of this is mind-blowing, really. But then it kind of makes me think something that I've been thinking for a long time, that the trade union and the community organisations have become the people who are actually developing the content of this, of the solutions and of the, you know, the knowledge that you have, all these things you are saying about the different is, which personally that doesn't bother me, but some people sort of think that the trade unions and the community organizations are there to just be activists rather than actually doing the work that someone else needs to do. Personally, I don't have a problem with it. I think the trade unions should be doing this, but then the council should give more money to the trade unions to do it. That would be good. And the other thing that this approach creates is that it's not like a one-off, because once you start proposing these ideas and, you know, there has to be like a review of the proposal, because like you said, like I was reading the stuff from last year and I thought, oh, some of these things are naive. So there has to be a continuous, which again, I don't mind, but I think the council should be paying the trade unions from now on to do this work. That's my idea. The council should be giving this work to the trade unions. So that's my point and the questions. Thank you.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, the council the council has no money. I mean, the council doesn't have enough. The work that they've done recently in Leeds, they have fitted insulation and heat pumps, for example, to a number of high-rise flats, and they took for that they took £1 million out of the housing revenue account, which is basically what they would normally use for repairs, you know, routine repairs and just, you know, the sort of retrofit that you do when units are worn out. And so it's very much a case of they're constantly applying for all these different funding pots, and they've had money, they've had EU money as well in the past, which presumably they won't have anymore. And what they really don't do is any overt campaigning. I mean, you say to them, well, you know, why aren't you shouting this from the rooftops, you know, about the funding cuts, about the things that you would like to do, the things that we need to campaign, you know, against the central government to do. And then you would have the community backing, instead of the community always saying, oh, the council, they just spend all their money on posh cars and business dinners or something, which they don't, but, you know. And their answer is always, oh, you don't know what you do. A lot of campaigning goes on behind the scenes, but it needs to not be behind the scenes. You know, in our view, I think, you know, everybody from the, you know, people who are on the left of the Labour Party, for example, will say the same, and people in the community groups, it needs to not be behind the scenes. We need to know, and we need a campaign that goes through, you know, the council and all the grassroots of the community as well.
Thanks for that, Ellen. I think there's a couple of links in the chat. So thanks to Pete and Stuart for providing those for us. And a couple of questions that you can maybe mull over, but I think what we'll do is move on to our next speaker now. That's okay with everybody. I don't see any other hands up there. So the last time we heard from Professor Linda Grant from the University of Westminster, she was fascinating in that she explained the amount of different buildings that were going to need retrofitted and the training requirements that were going to be needed and the job, the workforce, and it kind of blew my mind a bit. So I'm quite excited to hear her speak again. So with that, may I welcome Linda to speak to us tonight.
Thank you. I don't know whether I'm going to blow your mind again, because I didn't want to repeat what I said last time. Before I start, I just wanted to add a point about insulation. I recently went to Ireland and visited. They've set up two centres there, one in Enniscorthy and one in Waterford, on nearly zero energy building. One is focused on retrofit and one is focused on new build. And they do short courses for skilled construction workers there, including on insulation. So it may be worth you knowing about that. I can always send out details. But I was going to say something totally different today, really, because I thought it was rather important to give us a bit of background, if you like. And I started my life as a historian, and I've done a lot of labour history, and particularly I've done a lot on the history of direct labour. So I'm going to give a kind of very short Scottish-oriented picture of this. If I can share my screen, is that okay? Am I okay to share screen? Host disabled patient participant screen sharing. Can you enable me now?
Here you are. You're the co-host now, Linda.
Okay, I'll have another go. Here we are. So now, this is, I'll get rid of the pictures. This picture is Hugh Darcy. I don't know whether anybody remembered or knew him. And I had the honour of editing his autobiography, which was launched in Edinburgh just before, a few weeks actually before he died. Anyway, I kind of really feel we owe a lot to him. He spent his life fighting to improve conditions for building workers and ended up being the executive of UCAP. So I'm going to talk about transforming the vocational education and training system and the labour process and the way in which that certainly originated, or direct labour originated, in the whole municipal socialist movement, which of course, which began in the 1890s and which Engels was also involved in. But here's a quote from Anion Bevan from 1946. And it's a very handy quote because it fits in with this strike which Hugh helped to organise, the tea break strike, the famous Edinburgh tea break strike of 1946. If you don't know about it, then I've got plenty of copies of his autobiography. You can just ask me to send them. I'm happy to send a bulk of them. It's called A Bible of Discontent. But this is a quote from Anion Bevan, who says, when the honourable member says that the number of completed houses is not so great as he had hoped it would be, he must inquire for the reason into the organisation of the building industry and not in the government's plan for housing. And I think that's kind of a lesson that we should keep in mind. And particularly, now, many of you may not actually be aware of the whole long history of direct labour, but this is a kind of, this is what they are, direct labour, local authority building departments, publicly owned. They were intended to produce high quality work at reasonable cost. There was always a dispute between whether they were a service or whether they were trading as profit. As a service, they're accountable on the basis of cost. But anyway, the whole principle of direct labour was that socially and politically, or is that it's socially and politically accountable. Workers are employed under good, secure, trade union agreed employment and safe working conditions, and it has good quality training programmes. And in my view, really, I think that if we want a good standard of retrofitting, you have to have good employment and working conditions for the building workers concerned. So I'll just go back to the 1890s and why they were set up in 1890, which was on the basis of the Housing and Working Classes Act, which provided a legal framework for intervention. And they were first introduced in London, then later, not so long after, in Liverpool. It was really, they were introduced because of the problems with the building industry. A lot of scandals over the wringing of contracts and the quality of work. And also there was quite a change in political direction at the time in the councils, particularly with the setting up of the London County Council, which had a more progressive political flavour. And because at the same time, of course, of the emerging strength of trade unions, including for so-called unskilled workers, and the introduction of fair wages clauses for all public sector work. And at the same time, there was something of a problem with unemployment and ineffective public relief works. So that's where they started. I mean, in the 1890s, they were particularly prominent in areas in London. Battersea did all its work by direct labour. That's even kind of streets, lampposts, furniture for schools, everything. Now, then there was a big attack towards the, in the 1910s, about began in about 1908. And then came the war, but there was a big, big revival after the First World War, where they introduced much better working conditions, 44-hour week, payment for wet time, and where they were given a boost with the 1919 Housing Act, which sanctioned 70 direct labour schemes. So by 1924, there was... DLOs were building 10% of new council houses, 104,000 houses by 1928. This picture here that you see on your right is a lovely scheme in Glasgow from the 1930s, direct labour scheme. And at the time, of course, the private, as it is in many ways now, the private building industry was ill-equipped to cope with the scale of housing needed. And the Wheatley Act of 1924 provided subsidies and envisaged a 15-year programme of housing built by local authority at rents affordable by the working classes. But unfortunately, and this is a kind of pattern that set in, the many DLOs were forced to compete directly with the private sector with very narrow costing criteria. And they faced really rather massive Tory attacks, which began about 1928, rather ferociously. But the same phenomena, really, after the Second World War, a doubling in the number of DLOs, 41 local authorities by 1959, building by direct labour, and they employed altogether about 200,000 people, many and had many trainees. These are all schemes from Glasgow. So Glasgow set up its DLO in 1921. By the early 50s, it employed 5,500 building workers. And you'll see from the pictures, they had a precasting factory, a quarry, joinery workshop, as of course they do now. By 1977, which is in the 70s, I first looked at them in some detail, they employed 5,040 building workers, so rather the same number. Nowadays, of course, it's been transformed into City Building Glasgow, which employs 2,200, which I referred to last time, and has 250 trainees, all on a four-year training programme, very good and vastly oversubscribed. So I'm kind of, along with Ellen, and I've been involved in lots and lots of discussions on retrofit. These pictures, the house is within a training centre. I think that's the one in is that in Waterford or Enniscorthy, one or the other, in Ireland, one of the. So they have a house to show exactly how you achieve airtightness and insulation. The other picture is from Cardiff. Cardiff and Vale College, which now teaches heat pump installation. Now, actually, I kind of use that as a test to people in FEs. Are you training plumbers or electricians with heat pumps? And if the answer is not yet, then that, you know, that does really tell you something. But an alternative approach, which is what Ellen indicated for retrofitting, as I see it, would be a coalition of local authorities, unions, FE colleges to achieve an energy literate skilled construction workforce required, beginning with fuel poverty estates. And already, I mean, councils everywhere have been over the last years insourcing repair and maintenance, including where I live in Islington, and training and directly employing the workforce required. It just needs to be rather increased. Because insourcing has proved to these councils that it's much cheaper than using the private sector and much more cost effective, if you like. And FE colleges are gradually, as I've shown in Cardiff and Waterford, upgrading their construction workforces, because a lot of training has to be off-site. I mean, learning on the job really went as a way of learning, went out, in my view, almost in the 19th century. There's much more reliance on education, classrooms, workshops, as in this model house for trainees to understand airtightness. And in the other centre, there was also different forms of insulation for insulators. And then, of course, you need heat pumps, solar panels to learn, for the electrical and plumbing trainees to learn how these are installed. So this is really an important consideration, that you actually need to provide these workshops, and that, of course, costs something. So the vision, an accountable, large-scale, high-quality retrofit programme focused on energy saving and zero carbon construction, with a well-trained workforce employed under good trade union conditions. So that's finished. Now, how do I finish it now? Okay, I'll come out now. Okay, so I hope that gives you a bit of a flavour, and I hope, for the sake of Hugh Darcy and all the work he did, that we can carry on tradition of improving conditions for building workers.
Yeah, so thank you so much for that, and certainly thank you very much for sharing that Scottish slant with us. It's fantastic to hear that. I'm sure we're all delighted to look at those pictures and hear how they've done it in the past. And it does inspire you, doesn't it, to think, yeah, well, if we've done it before, we can do that again. So is there anyone here that would like to ask a question of Linda just now? I've got a couple of hands, Linda. Des, then Brian, please. Des first, please.
I just wanted to say that I knew you to ask you quite well in the 1970s. And I knew when he was eventually president of UKET, also president of TUC, et cetera, et cetera. But he was a very active trade union person, not only in UKET, but he was also very active in Edinburgh TUC in the 70s. That's all I wanted to say.
Okay, thanks for that, Des. Brian.
Yeah, thanks, Claire. And thank you, Linda. That was really inspiring. I wonder, you mentioned about councils insourcing their repairs and maintenance. I wonder, is it possible for you to share the names of some of the councils with us, not necessarily here, but by email or something like that, so that we can take on our own council and use those names of councils to actually wave at them and hit them with? I mean, our council recently redid its contract for its buildings. It's not its council houses, because those are done in-house, although a lot of it is actually contracted out. But they recently had I think it was £180 million contracts that they awarded to Skanska and Mighty for repairs and maintenance in schools and other types of council buildings. So I don't know if you can reflect just now on that or give us the details of the councils. Thank you.
Well, I'm happy to. I mean, in fact, a few years ago, we organised a seminar on direct labour, and somebody turned up who was an insourcing consultant. He went round advising local authorities on how to insource. But actually, I looked up recently. There used to be an organisation called ADLO, which I don't know whether anybody remembers. It was the Association of Direct Labour Organisations. And they did quite a good job in coordinating across the local authorities. Now, they've changed their name in 2000. And I should have prepared myself, and I can't remember what. It's something like public service something. Anyway, I looked it up this week to discover that they recently organised a conference on insourcing. So I'll dig it out and try and send it around.
Okay, thanks, Linda. Just having a quick look for any more hands, and then I think we're going to move on to our next speaker, if that's okay with everyone. So Stuart Graham is here from Glasgow Trade Union Council. The last time he spoke, he was concerned about sources of funding, outsourcing work to private companies that care mostly about their shareholders, and he was really worried about keeping money in the city. So I'm really interested to hear him speak tonight, and I welcome him into the meeting, Stuart.
All right, thanks very much, Claire, and cheers, folks, for having us back. Okay, so yeah, as Claire said, the last time I spoke, we were kind of really just starting in Glasgow to get a bit of an idea of how to develop this campaign. So, and I suppose it probably doesn't have a final look yet, because we're still considering the kind of coalition building we need to do around this, and whether how much of it needs to sit at a local level and how much needs to sit at a national level. And I suppose part of this is coloured by the feedback that we got from the Glasgow City Region retrofit and feasibility study. So that reported around about the start of October, and took the opportunity to meet with one of the lead officers involved with that 2 weeks before COP. It was just in mid-October. So, and I suppose in terms of some of the figures, no, I don't think it's as easy as just multiplying them by three, but the area we're talking about in terms of the Glasgow City region has just under 900,000 homes. And Scotland has, I think it's around about 2.6 million homes. So we're talking about, the Glasgow City region's got about, round about a third of the homes that are going to be affected by this. Now, I suppose the initial appraisal or the initial estimate of funding requirements for this up to 2035 is 20 billion. In terms of what that actually means, we've got, of those 886,000 homes, or like I said, 900,000 is an easier number to work with, 428,000, or just under half of them, are going to require significant most of the work. So that was costed at just under 11 billion, with a recurring cost of about 600,000 a year, sorry, 600 million a year, towards the properties that don't need as much work to that. So what does that actually mean? We've got, and it was interesting to see Des's kind of report. I'm not going to mention too much about that, just other than to kind of reference the archetype houses, because I suppose this is, whenever I've been talking to folk or reading about it, and particularly talking to some of the small business and cooperative folk that have sprung up over the COP26 that I've managed to get in contact with. Really, although there might be myriad numbers, we probably need to start looking at what archetype houses actually mean and getting some kind of template. So for the Glasgow City region, we're probably talking of pre-1919 tenements, post-war tenements, four in a blocks, multi-story flats, semi-detached and detached properties. But realistically, most of the population lives in the flats. Most of the population live in some kind of block, which is probably going to be affected by mixed tenure. And going back to the, I suppose, one of the big obstacles and risks to the delivery of a mass programme of retrofit. After funding, the second biggest risk is working with owner-occupiers. So I suppose looking at 20 billion in terms of an overall funding estimate for a 15-year plan, which is interesting. Whenever Linda was talking about the Wheatley Act and the 15-year plan, I think we find ourselves in kind of the same, might not be exactly the same scenario, but the same kind of time scale. We're looking at the same type of scale of problem around housing. But also with that mixed tenure approach, we know that, you know, anybody that lives in a like I do, in a close, you know, if you've got a factored property and you need to end up having a vote or achieve some type of consensus, if there's large works that are going to be proposed or that are going to be required, then one or two people can block that, particularly if it comes to significant amount of cost. Now, only 1.8 billion has been committed over this parliamentary term by the Scottish Government, which, if I suppose what we're talking about in terms of the scale of funding, doesn't suggest that there's enough, nowhere near enough political will that sits behind this at this moment in time. 20 billion, just as a kind of maybe way to contrast it, 20 billion is 10% of Trident. 20 billion is also what's spent nationally on standard repairs for homes. So that's a recurring cost, not for UK-wide, sorry, not nationally Scotland-wide, but nationally UK-wide. So I suppose in terms of money well spent, it would actually make more sense to spend the money on not just repairing, but addressing those repairs as part of an actual retrofit programme. Now, I suppose one of the other questions that springs to mind around, because let's face it, right, the report from Glasgow City Region wasn't particularly contentious. It just doesn't suggest that it identifies the risks, but it doesn't seem to go for the scale that I suppose a lot of people, if not everybody on here, would insist upon, but also that the climate crisis demands. But the need to, I suppose, the use of energy performance certificate level C as a standard to get everybody to, that suggests to me that net zero is the end game for local authorities, rather than it being a yard, you know, like a measuring post or a way station on the way to real zero. So there, you know, in terms of getting properties up to what would by that point in time be considered the minimum standard, is that enough? Is that really what we're, or are we actually looking for something that is going to be done at a better scale to the likes of Passive House Standard or some of the other technical specifications that I'm not familiar with? But I suppose during COP, I went to a couple of architects events, and at one of them, I was the only person who wasn't an architect as well. So again, that kind of idea that there's people operating in kind of groups or in professional silos or that aren't connected enough yet is points that are, you know, that are well made and are keep being repeated within these types of meetings as well. But some of the issues around scale, because not just in Glasgow, there's a couple of co-ops that have sprung up over the south side of Glasgow. And then there's an example in Manchester called People Powered Retrofit, which has been doing fantastic retrofitting work. But this is, you know, their market is people who can afford it. And at the minute, I'm talking to some of the folk who were involved in that, who, again, are totally on board with the type of proposals that we're talking about. They just don't want to be disadvantaged. They want to fit into a kind of bigger meta framework or macro level around this. But less than 1% of the properties are in the whole of the UK are retrofitted sufficiently. And I'd ask the question then about what's the kind of trigger level for scale? And it's 10%. But even at the minute, talking to various people around this over the course of the last few months, if every contractor in the UK and Scotland turned their business to retrofitting right now, there wouldn't be enough of them. But even more than that, there wouldn't be enough supply lines. The supply line capacity does not exist to do this, nor does the local supply line capacity exist, because realistically, if we're talking about a market for, you know, markets for heat pumps and different types of, you know, external wall insulation, see, at the minute, the prices of that just keep going up because a lot of it is being imported. So there is not a local production capacity for this. And I suppose even whenever you're talking about where this is coming from, because this going, sorry to keep chopping and changing, but this is just where my head is to try and explain this. Because the pipelines of funding don't exist at scale, and local authorities or anyone that's wanting to do this type of work, housing associations are actually having to competitively tender for it. There needs to be a change in order to create the longer term funding around this that doesn't consider that there's going to be a risk. Then how are you going to build in the climate conscious or the green factors into your tendering requirements that are going to reflect that you're cutting carbon within this process, that your building site is as low carbon or as carbon neutral as possible? Some of the aspects that you know, I mean, again, that are being looked at outside of the UK, particularly in the Nordic and Scandinavian countries, and some of the feedback we've had from Danish building industry would suggest that's higher prioritized within the industry as well. But I suppose, how do I bring this around then? Because there's not only is there the lack of political will and the lack of scale around this, but I also think there's a lack of genuine political honesty around decision making, because there seems to be this, you know, we're very aware of the procrastination side of things where it's kicking it down the line. And that could be because there's, you know, the agency saying, oh, we're not sure if it's going to be heat pumps, or we're not sure if it's going to be district heating, and that one necessarily excludes the other. Or that if it's going to be a mass program of retrofitting, is it deep retrofitting that's done all at once, or is it done in a way that is as least disruptive as possible? But there's a property that's just half a mile down the road from my property, and I walk my dog past it on a regular basis to see how it's getting on. That is a deep retrofit that's being done by Southside Housing Association and John Gilbert Architects that has taken approximately 3 to 4 months. It required everybody to move out of the building in order to bring it up. They are working to a passive house standard. So whether it's something that can be done gradually or whether it has to be done that level of invasively, there needs to be a discussion about whether decant accommodation is required, if that's the case, because the temporary accommodation situation in across the whole of the country we know is pretty poor, but it's also a racket. You know, if somebody had to move out of a property into temporary accommodation that was funded along the lines of temporary accommodation for homeless clients, then you would end up paying more for that accommodation while you were subsidizing the cost of your own accommodation being moved out. So, and I suppose that what we really need is that is a genuine solution for mixed types of tenure. And the Scottish Government will not consider legislation on this before 2025, I've been advised. And they are also scoping the legal implications of compelling home adaptations through legislation. I think that's to do with Article 8, privacy rights, rather than Article 1, Protocol 1 of the European Convention of Human Rights, which is about everybody's right to accommodation. I don't know where that leaves us. That's the kind of the question, so a kind of summary of some of the questions and obstacles that have presented itself over the last few months, as either as a combination of feedback through the feasibility study, discussions that we've been having with, you know, anyone who'll talk to us about retrofitting, let's be honest, and a bit of scoping about where we need to maybe focus our attentions within Glasgow. I've been speaking to, I went to speak at Western Bartonshire Trades Council meeting as well, particularly because it's their councillor that is the lead on this. But interestingly enough, over the course, just after COP, Glasgow Trades Council would be contacted by Patrick Harvey to set up a meeting on the 13th of January, we're meeting with him anyway. So Patrick Harvey, for the guys that aren't Scottish based, is the new, well, not that new, but of the within this administration, he's the Minister for Zero Carbon Buildings, Active Travel and Tenants' Rights. And I suppose, again, keen to get an interface with Scottish Government around this to ask some of these questions, but conscious also that this is being devolved at a city region level. So the points that Ellen had made about West Yorkshire under the mayor in the area, and I think that's being reflected in Manchester too, just in terms of some of the amount of the discussions that are taking place. But this is very much has to be driven regionally, where we know that the campaigning groups and the leverage exists, but there has to be clearer lines and clearer accountability and clearer commitment to the longer term aspect around this at either Westminster or Holyrood level. Because using that figure of 20 billion for Glasgow is a kind of rough kind of estimate. I know that from talking to the guys from People Powered Retrofit that Manchester was scoped at something like 32 or 33 billion. That it's probably this type of block funding and the ability for local authorities and municipally delivered programs to absorb that longer term cost is where the leverage needs to be. So I think I've probably been talking for a fair bit and I'll stop talking.
Thanks very much for that, Stuart. I think it probably segues quite well straight into asking Des to speak now, because I know he's going to talk about funding within his report. So Des, can I pass straight over to you just now, and then we'll take questions at the end, please?
Yeah, since our last meeting, I've had a couple of meetings with council officials. We've also done quite a lot of reading on retrofitting, and I keep discovering new stuff about it. And recently I've been reading a report which was produced by what's called the Zero Emissions Social Housing Task Force, and that was published at the end of August 2021. And it's a sort of report that was led by the Scottish executive of the sort of housing associations. And so I thought that was a very interesting report, and anyone's interested in the topic, I'd recommend that they read it. It isn't too long, but it's got lots of, I think, interesting information. But looking at some overall points first, before I deal with some of the sort of policy points in my reports. I mean, in Edinburgh, there's about 200,000 homes. The council has about 20,000 houses. That's not its own interest in energy efficiency, because it's planning the next 10 years to build 10,000 council houses, which they will say are going to be built to retrofitting or to energy efficient standards. I think that's a very important angle of all things, that new housing should be built to the standards that we expect from in terms of retrofitted housing, but the council are busy doing that. You also see the council interest is only a small minority really of houses in Edinburgh. And I've read some stuff about social housing and retrofitting, but I've read nothing practical about private sector housing and retrofitting. There doesn't seem to be any real plan about that whatsoever. And I'd be interested in people's views on that. The other one overall point I want to make at the start is that there's absolutely no plan to use GLOs, or it's all about doing all the work in partnership with the private sector. And that is whether it's doing pilot work next year, 2022, or the long-term work in retrofitting, or whether it's just council housing, or whether it's social housing, or whether it's private sector housing, it's all going to be left up to with the private sector. There's simply no intention to do otherwise. There's absolutely no talk either at our local authority level or as a Scottish government level, or creating some sort of DLO either at a local level or a Scottish level to tackle this major strategical work. And we've heard from Stuart how much money is going to be involved. It's going to be billions and billions, £8 billion alone in Edinburgh to retrofit all its houses. And so the private sector are going to gobble this up. And the record of the private sector in doing work for the public is really terrible, at least in Edinburgh. But we know all the lessons of Grenfell. So I mean, why everyone, all the establishment is totally committed to working in partnership with the private sector, I don't know. But I think it's the issue that the unions have to take up. That this model is deemed to be produce quality work, is deemed to be efficient, is deemed to be cost effective. And I want to see the evidence for that. I've yet to read any evidence about whether, about why the Scottish government thinks that working in partnership with the private sector ensures quality or ensures efficiency. It's just accepted as has to be done that way. After all these meetings, I wrote the report, which I can give to people, but I decided it might be worthwhile to draft some policy points, and I've screen sharing to show you the policy points. And my first point is really all about the issue of fuel, of tackling fuel poverty. Everyone says that, you know, one of the points of retrofitting, which will make it politically acceptable, is that it will, you know, make homes warmer and will reduce the cost of electricity to tenants. But they all say at the same time, we can't guarantee that. And they can't guarantee it for a number of reasons. But I think one of the new reasons I found out today was that one of the reasons they can't guarantee it is because they can't guarantee the cost of energy. We've all read about the gas crisis and, you know, the rise in the cost of gas and all these energy firms going bankrupt. And they say it's a real concern that they simply cannot guarantee that council tenants' rent will not increase, that they can't guarantee that it will not be used to finance retrofitting. I think that applies to private sector tenants as well. So I think that it's a very big, should be a very big demand from the trade union and labour movement, is that retrofitting must not allow rent increases to finance it. We must say that's a red line, we are not going to allow it, and say to the Scottish government and local authorities, you must not let this happen. You may get, like, rents might increase, like in Edinburgh a few years, it's at 2%, and there's a rent freeze this year, but I mean, we've got to say this rent increases should not finance retrofitting. But at the moment, none of the papers that I've read say, don't rule out rent increases. I think that's an important point. And then this question of quality, like we all know from, you know, what we read about the construction industry, that they fiddle quality. They say something's going to be done in a quality way, but it isn't done in a quality way. But what's the Scottish government, how the Scottish government and Edinburgh City Council are going to guarantee quality? Well, they say there's going to be a national public energy agency, which will, you know, sort of look at quality, but it's only advisory. It's going to have no enforcement powers. The private sector, who are going to do all the work, are supposed to appoint a quality retrofit coordinator, designer, assessor and evaluator. But in other words, the private sector is expected to police itself in terms of quality and efficiency. And I think the trade union movement have severe reservations about the private sector from its record in history, particularly the last 10 years in policing itself. But that is the plans for the Scottish Government, and it's been accepted by our City Council, is that the private sector will police itself. And the council says it has plans to ensure that there should be an independent or council quantity surveyor who signs off on works. But I mean, anyone who's employed by a local authority, I welcome their views of whether that will actually work. Is that enforcement? I don't think it really is enforcement, but maybe I'm wrong about that. And the other question is, it's to do with quality, but I mean, who monitors the planning and retrofitting in social and private sector housing in Edinburgh? And I talked to council officials about how the city council will monitor the whole program of retrofitting in the city. They say that it's too much resources, it's impossible. The council doesn't have the staff to monitor the strategy of retrofitting in Edinburgh. And so I think that is, and that other papers say this, is that retrofitting can only be successful if you abandon austerity as far as local authorities are concerned. But the Scottish Government has no intention of abandoning austerity. And some people say retrofitting won't work unless you do away with austerity. And in other words, local authorities are given the resources to do the work or the resources to raise the money. Point four is about the cost of retrofitting. City Council for its own housing stock say it will cost 700 million in 10 years. But and they say, officials tell me, the main way that will be raised is by in the housing revenue accounts. And they say, because the interest rate is so low, only 1% at the moment, borrowing from this sort of public sector board, that's loans board, that they can afford it. But whether they can afford it or not is solely dependent on their interest rate. If the economics of the situation changes and the interest rate goes up, then they won't be able to afford it, the borrowing, or they won't be able to afford it without putting up rents. So the local authority way of financing it, which is mostly from borrowing, doesn't rule out. They say they hope it won't result in rent increases, but they don't rule it out. So in fact, they say they accept it may turn out that it's actually council tenants pay for retrofitting, and that the bulk of retrofitting would be paid by council tenants, and retrofitting of other houses would be paid by other tenants. So I think that's very important that, you know, the Labour movement really puts a red line about this, that we're not going to pay for retrofitting. And we need to put pressure on the Scottish Government about that. The other thing the officials said to me is that, you know, if you did a full retrofitting programme in Edinburgh, there isn't the building workers to do that. And there's you can argue about how many building workers are needed, but my own personal figure is about 2,000 will be needed in Edinburgh to carry out a full ongoing retrofitting programme. Local authority officials say there isn't the workers available to do that. They say that because young people aren't interested in construction apprentices, because wages and conditions are so low, and because loads of migrant workers from places like Poland, etc., have now left Scotland, there simply isn't the staff exists at the moment. And correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it's ridiculous to think that the private sector will create an effective workforce to carry out retrofitting in the city. I haven't read any single plan that will create this workforce in the city of Edinburgh. And they're hoping to get things going like full steam ahead in 2023. But everyone will know that if you're going to create that type of skilled workforce, it's going to take a bit longer than that. And work would need to start right now. But as far as I know, there are no plans, either the City Council or the Scottish Government, to create the workforce that is needed. They say that can be left completely to the private sector, which, as I said before, I think that's ridiculous, a ridiculous assumption. And so I'm just going to finish there because of the time and say that, you know, I've made these 5 points. I hope they will be endorsed in some form or other by the Trades Council at its meeting later in this month, on the 14th of December. But I'm thinking of really good to make these 5 points into a motion for the STUC in April 2022. And we're having a debate on motions in January, a meeting on the 11th of January. So I'd say this to Stuart, that I'd welcome such a motion that we can look at as well from Glasgow. It'd be, I think, really good for Trades Councils to get together and think about what type of motion would be needed in retrofitting. Finally, where do we go from here? I mean, I hear what people are saying about coalitions and alliances. We have to develop that. But I think we also need to inform ourselves. And I've actually, through our reading, I found that in Edinburgh anyway, there's two experts on retrofitting. And one of them is a guy called Sean Smith, who's a professor of engineering at Edinburgh University. And apparently he's been involved in all these working groups on retrofitting and has analysed all the problems. And he might be a useful speaker at a meeting in January. And another person is this chief executive of the Scottish Housing Association's employers. She spoke at meeting to a COP26 on apparently on retrofitting. And she's chair of this task force I mentioned dealing with retrofitting. So I think she's another possible speaker that we might try and get hold of in January too. So I think, yeah, we've got to build alliances, we've got to build coalitions. We also, I think, have to have a program of informing us and the public about what is actually really going on, because my 5 points, I think, what I've outlined is a kind of scandal. No workforce, they don't know how to finance it, and they may well get tenants to finance it if we don't insist that that doesn't happen. And I think that's ultimately, it's my final point. The biggest challenge for the movement, I think, is to make sure that tenants don't pay for retrofitting. People realise that they're not going to support it. They're going to oppose retrofitting at all. The whole thing will be a lot of opposition. And of course, it's needed. Energy efficient housing is needed. So we should be encouraging it, but we can't encourage it because it means that people are going to pay more rent, and also they're going to have to pay more on electricity. So that's all I have to say. Thanks for listening to me.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Des. Thanks for all your research and for reporting on the meeting that you've had with officials. I'm sure there'll be lots of people that would like to ask you or Stuart, or maybe have formulated questions for any of our other speakers. So I would invite you to stick your digital hand up and I will bring you in. Okay, I've got Ian and then Pete, please. Ian first.
Thanks, Claire, and thanks to everyone that spoke tonight. Really informative. I was at the last meeting with the council officials, with Des, and everything that Stuart and Des have said tonight, I wouldn't disagree with. There's loads of issues around the retrofitting strategy document that certainly Edinburgh has, but that's wider spread through probably the whole of Scotland around supplies, contractors, financing, timescales. I think what it says a lot that until the Edinburgh TUC actually stepped in and questioned the council around the retrofitting strategy, there had been no consultation with the trade unions, any of them, in relation to that. And that's including our own building maintenance teams. The strategy that myself, Des and Carmen have seen for the first meeting indicated that there should have been already 3 pilot schemes undertaken, and the retrofitting of all Edinburgh's housing stock should have been complete by 2030. But it says, as Des said there, it says very little, if anything at all, about how it's going to be funded. In fact, what it does say is that there will be a real issue with the funding, bearing in mind that the Scottish Government do not intend to actually fund retrofitting until 2040, and yet they want to have their strategy complete by 2030. The other thing that myself and Des raised at the last meeting, and I've no doubt that Glasgow will be the same, is the vast majority of the remainder of the housing stock is either in tenemental or high-rise blocks. And there is no guarantee that the tenants of these properties will allow access. And there is no way that you can actually force them to allow access either. The other thing that I've read quite a few documents now, as well as the Edinburgh one, and I have not come across anything that mentions the effect that the installation of asbestos in properties is going to have in relation to the timescales carrying out this work. Because we all know that, for instance, Edinburgh's housing stock, I would say probably all 22,000 remaining council house owned properties were all pre-built before 1990, when asbestos was stopped in the construction industry. Obviously, to carry out a full retrofit, you are going to have to remove windows, you're going to have to replace central heating, you're going to have to go into lofts and look at, putting insulation in, you're going to have to fit new pumps and et cetera. You are going to come across at some stage asbestos, which will be disturbed, and that will cause a delay. There has been no study done on that I can find anywhere. So I think that's one of the issues that needs to be addressed. The social side of housing, i.e., private housing. I mean, my professional job with the council is an enforcement officer for private rented services. And whilst I deal mainly with HMOs, which are regulated and have to meet certain standards, non-HMOs don't have to meet any standard apart from fire regulations now. And I have been in some horrific properties in Edinburgh where there has literally been wall to ceiling mould. Completely substandard. So there's a number of issues. I personally, I know for a fact that Edinburgh will not meet the 2030 deadline for their strategy. I have serious doubts if any Scottish authority will meet it by 2040. And they'll be lucky if at least three quarters of them have done it by 2050. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Ian. Pete, then Graham, please.
Yeah, thanks, Claire. Thanks to the speakers. I thought the coverage was actually really brilliant. And I was particularly taken by what Linda said about the tendency for some councils to start insourcing again, because it does seem to me, just building on what Des said, that we've got a real problem both in Edinburgh and in with the Scottish Government as well, that this just seems to be a sense that the private sector in the market is the only game in town, and that's the only solution to things. And that's not just about climate initiative, it's about care and a whole bunch of other things as well. And I do think as a campaigning priority, it's just essential we turn that round, because I mean, Des has already said much of it, but it just doesn't bear thinking about if you think about the private sector being given the commission to do retrofitting. Leaving aside the shortage of jobs and things like that, I mean, the ability to maintain standards will be minimal, because most of the big contractors work by subcontracting to subcontractors who then subcontract to other subcontractors. And nobody takes responsibility for standards or skills or training, because ultimately, it's so fragmented. And so any plan for retrofitting at scale has to include plans for training and education. And it has to include all those infrastructural things as well. And I don't think you have to be a socialist to think that this requires systematic coordination, and it requires a public sector initiative. And so I think much of the detailed work that's been done is really important, but there comes a point at which actually, unless we actually also win that political argument by really, really strong campaigning, that it has to be the responsibility of the public sector, I think it's not going to be not ready by 2030. It's going to be much, much longer than that. It's really difficult to see how things are going to happen. So I'll stop there.
Okay, thanks for that, Pete. Graham and then Linda, please.
I just first to say thanks to all the speakers. I think it was fantastic, and a huge big thanks to Des for all the work that he's done in Edinburgh on this. It's been absolutely sterling. I think on point five, it's absolutely scandalous to suggest the workforce isn't there, because I think one thing that I would really like to see done with this, with the job creation aspect, is focus on young people in the communities being retrofitted themselves. I think if this is an opportunity for young people who are forced into precarious labour, the service industries are disposable, to learn skills that are going to be skills for life. And essentially, I mean, we also have a huge amount of young people interested in climate and environment. So to suggest there's not the certainly the potential workforce there is absolutely scandalous. And I think also, I mean, the council could see this, it could be an advertising opportunity for the council themselves, for them to pick young people coming out of these schemes to retrofit their own communities. It's an absolutely beautiful story, writes itself, and give them careers that will see them in good stead for the rest of their lives. I don't know whether Stuart or Ellen have got any experience of sort of apprenticeships coming in off the back of this, but I think certainly the next step needs to be looking at working with Skills Development Scotland and perhaps building up some idea of an apprenticeship programme for this, especially if they're coming out with nonsense that there's not people there to do the jobs.
Great, thanks for that, Graham. I love that idea. Linda, please, and then
Brian. I just wanted to pick up some of those ideas. What Ian said about asbestos clearance and retrofit is, I think, a really important point. It's also something that's been pursued by the European Federation of Building and Woodworkers, because there's obviously no point in retrofitting if you've got an asbestos ridden, you know, you have to clear the asbestos as well. But I was going to say that I did some interviews around Cardiff, including an organisation called Zero Carbon Homes, and they've done a lot of retrofit programmes, particularly the kind of software that's needed to go with it. But the reason they say zero carbon is because they very much recommend that you should think about zero carbon and not zero energy. That means that they relate their programme of retrofit to the decarbonisation of the grid and also to the using materials that aren't carbon intensive. So to think in terms of carbon rather than energy is probably, I think, quite helpful. It also, of course, includes insulation materials, because there's an awful lot going on now in terms of insulation materials, including those that involve nanotechnology, that could potentially be extremely damaging for building workers to handle. So we really have to think very, very hard about that. And we all know the lessons of Grenville. You know, it just doesn't work. It's and to read all the inquiry at the moment, which I've been following for months now, is quite horrific about how passing the buck, which is what Pete talked about. But anyway, I'd like to thank Des for producing a lovely document. It's great.
Okay,
I was going to just add one point.
Oh, sure.
I mean, I've gone on about DLOs, but, you know, before Thatcher took the axe to them, or tried to, there were quite a number of Tory DLO, Tory councils that had DLOs too. It wasn't just Labour. And that's always worth making that point to people, you know, because they had to get the work done.
Okay, yeah, great point. Thank you. Okay, Brian, would you like to come in here?
Yeah, thanks, Claire, and thanks, Linda. I've just checked. I've got a link for the Association of DLOs or whatever it is. So anything else you can share, please, it would be really helpful. Just to pick up on Graham's point there about Skills Development Scotland and apprentices, and you can't do this kind of thing, the size of what might be possible, you can't do it without actually the likes of Skills Development Scotland, but also without going into schools. You need, sorry to get Soviet style on you, we need a 5-year and a 10-year plan. And that would include looking at schools, looking at the curriculum, getting the Scottish Government interested, and saying, well, what people are presently in first year in certain secondary school that may be interested in 4 years' time in an apprenticeship that would last another 4 years. So you're talking about an 8 years there already. So that's why I say a 10-year plan, but it certainly, it can and must be done. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that point, Brian. Just going to check. Anybody else that wants to come in here near the end of our meeting? There's a couple of comments in the, and links again in the chat. So thanks very much for those. Oh, Hilary, I see your hand's gone up. Would you like to add your comment now, please?
Yes, sorry, I can't put my camera on. There's something wrong with my camera. I hate asking a question without people seeing you. It looks really rude. But I think this has been a really great meeting, but there's so much. It's like, you know, all the chickens are coming home to roost now after decades of austerity. And this is one of the issues where all the things that have been wrong with capitalism in the last 50 years are now really, really at crisis point. So there's so much to cope with here. So it, in a way, it's quite difficult to take it piece by piece because it's such a huge subject. But I think, you know, if we're thinking about a January meeting, the speakers that Des suggested would be very good. Could I also suggest, not necessarily for the January meeting, but that we involve the EIS and the UCU too in trying to get a discussion about training, training for retrofitting in colleges. This seems to be, it's absolutely tragic that, you know, the Edinburgh Council is saying they don't have any skills. Tragic. And I'm wondering, I would like to ask Stuart, is Glasgow Council this bad? Do they have so few skills at hand and are they so wedded to the private sector? That's it. Thank you.
Can you come, Stuart?
Yeah, cool. Well, actually, that's perfect, Hilary, because I was gonna make a point about city building as well. Now, Glasgow City Council love the private sector. Glasgow City Council are an SNP administration that are absolutely falling over themselves to throw contracts at the private sector. So no different from Edinburgh. The city building model, I appreciate Linda's now no longer on the call, but the city building model, I suppose there's the theory of city building, of in-house public sector workforce that's capable of delivering. It's predominantly repairs to ongoing RSL properties because Glasgow doesn't have, Glasgow is no longer a landlord. The only responsibility it has for any properties with either commercial properties or homeless properties, which they get from lets off each of the housing associations. But as a model, yep, it probably looks dead attractive. And is that attractive? See, in practice, as somebody whose substantive post is in homelessness and has a regular up until I got full facility time, had a regular interface with pretty much all the housing associations in Glasgow. City building's nowhere near what you would consider to be a consistent level of building standard. Now, that's not to be unfair towards practitioners who have been working in city building and have developed this for timed served professions over the years. And this was a point that was actually made by Tom Kirby at West Dumbartonshire meeting. He had zoomed in from Fife. But there's a concern around time served tradesmen having their skills diluted by a prospective retrofitting one size fits all kind of building standards approach. Now, if you're looking at how that concern probably has come into being, it could well be because of the lack of quality in some people's experience in building repairs, particularly if it's being carried out by city building is that it's not a quality service. It can be done and they can respond within a certain amount of time, but the quality of that repair work is not consistent. And particularly for the modern apprentices that have come through and maybe don't have the same amount of experience in terms of years and may not have had the same level of guidance in terms of people who were supervising their apprenticeships. But that is a common complaint from both housing associations and from tenants, particularly folk that have been recipients of repairs that are in temporary accommodation. I have some friends that are on boards of housing associations in Glasgow, and I know that this, although it's the only, I suppose one of the reasons that they keep paying for the service is because it's a 24/7 service and it can kick in. But is that currently proficient enough to deliver what the type of stuff that we're talking about here? I don't think that it is for a second, no.
Right, many thanks for that, Stuart. I think we can say we've definitely moved forward in our thinking where we are now from where we are 5 months ago when we met in the summertime. Things are definitely moving on, but the scale still seems impossibly large, doesn't it? I think we really have to count ourselves very fortunate to have had such a wonderful meeting just now and such terrific speakers. So can I say thank you very much to everybody for sharing their time with us tonight and adding their contributions to our meeting. It's been really fascinating. I've certainly learned a lot tonight. I think we've also got some really great ideas for moving forward, and our trade unionism working on getting training up and running and really pressurising the government that they can't just ask private companies to pay more to their shareholders and not actually do the jobs properly. So I think we've got quite a clear direction of where we're going. So I'll look forward to our next meeting, whenever that may be, hopefully in the new year. But with that, I think I will wish you all a very Merry Christmas and have a great break. Whatever you're doing, keep safe and healthy. And I look forward to seeing you at the next meeting. So thanks very much for tonight. Good night.
Night, everyone.
Bye.
Cheers, bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.